Так, работает, да?
Да.
Добрый день, уважаемые участники конкурса, члены жюри, коллеги, присутствующие, гости нашего фестиваля. Я обращаюсь к вам с приветственным словом, с тем, чтобы открыть данное мероприятие, посвященная 26-му фестивалю студентов вузов физической культуры с международным участием. Называется этот конкурс докладов «История развития спортивного движения в регионе». Позвольте представить жюри, которое будет оценивать ваши доклады. Председатель секции Яковлюк Александр Николаевич, доктор филологических наук, профессор, заведующий кафедрой иностранных языков университета Лесгофта, Санкт-Петербург. Заместитель председателя Якунина Татьяна Вячеславовна, доктор педагогических наук, заведующая кафедрой китайской филологии университета Герцена. Председатель предметно-методической комиссии по китайскому языку в городе Санкт-Петербурге. Члены жюри. Катаева Светлана Владимировна, кандидат филологических наук, доцент. Запрудская Ольга Вадимовна. Шестопалов Александр Александрович. В данной аудитории проводится конкурс докладов на иностранном языке. В конкурсе участвуют представители 15 вузов физической культуры. Последовательность выступления определена на жеребьевке. Оценка по каждому критерию производится по трехбалльной системе. Результаты оценок жюри с оценочных листов переносятся в компьютер, где посредством специально разработанного алгоритма производится подсчет баллов и выявление мест, занятых докладчиками. Победителем становится участник, набравший наибольший средний балл, при этом средний балл округляется до сотых. В случае равного количества баллов у двух и более участников председатель жюри обладает решающим голосом при выявлении призового места. При выявлении в ходе конкурса несоответствия содержания доклада заявленной в программе тематики или тематики секции, докладчик выступает вне конкурса. Оценивается доклад продолжительностью до 7 минут. Время ответов на вопросы до 3 минут. Временный регламент контролируется секретарем. Уважаемые участники конкурса, я обращаю ваше внимание на строгое выполнение регламента. Согласно регламенту, у вас есть право после того, когда секретарь скажет о том, что время вашего доклада истекло, за вами остается право закончить предложение, которое вы начали. Дальше вам не следует продолжать доклад. Почему? Потому что тогда у вас не останется времени на ответы на вопросы. И по этой позиции вы можете получить оценку 0. Обращаюсь к вам, будьте предельно аккуратны со временем. Да, пожалуйста. Да. Да. Уважаемый Андрей Александрович, я долгое время, больше 20 лет, являлся судьей национальной категории по футболу, да, и есть такое правило, незыблемое. Во время соревнований регламент не изменяется. Вот если у нас в регламенте было прописано то, что я сказал, вот оно так должно исполняться. Если мы хотим что-то изменить, то изменяем только после окончания конкурса. Обсуждение, да. Да. Ну, я думаю, что мы не вправе изменять регламент. Он есть, и мы его будем выполнять. Поэтому всем выступающим желаю успехов. И, пожалуйста, чтобы голос не дрожал, потому что я вчера смотрел выступление наших студентов, конкурсантов, и у вас дрожал очень сильно голос. Комиссия. добродушная, справедливая. Я думаю, что оценки будут объективны. Благодарю вас за внимание. Пожалуйста, Александр Николаевич, вам слово.
Спасибо большое за предоставление слова. Значит, уважаемые гости нашего фестиваля, коллеги, единственное, что хотел обратить ваше внимание, на трибуне стоит микрофон. Ваше дело нажать на левую кнопку. А он уже постоянно работает, не отключается. Забудьте про кнопку, сосредоточьтесь на докладе. Ladies and gentlemen, we are beginning our meeting. И первым у нас по жребию идет Барабанов Никита Алексеевич. Подготовится Смирнова Юлия Александровна. Успехов!
Dear colleagues, members of the Commission, let me present to your attention the report on the topic Quantitative-Qualitative Assessment of Development and Current State of Cultivated Sports in Moscow, on the example of track and field. Historically, Moscow became the capital of our homeland, but the right to be the sports capital must be earned. A goal set by the president to reach the target of 55% involvement of citizens of Russia in regular physical exercises by 2024 is being achieved. And it's very reason to believe that it will be achieved. Today, there are more than 5,000 coaches in 123 kinds of sport in Moscow. There are more than 64,000 athletes have sports ranks in our region. In 2022, 4,884 athletes from Moscow were members of the national teams of Russia. It's very important to analyze and compare the development of various kinds of sport in our region and other regions. It's very big, very important, and obviously not finished work. We decided to analyze the most medal generating, the most popular kind of sport, the track and field. The subject of our research is quantitative-qualitative indicators, characterizing the development and current state in track and field in Moscow. The purpose is to identify these indicators. The following methods were used to achieve this purpose. We analyzed the performance of Moscow athletes in Russian Athletics Championship from 1909 to 2022, which allowed us to determine the level of Moscow sports in Russian arena in different time periods. An expert assessment was also conducted to assess the development of track and field in Moscow. It was attended by 6 teachers of our university. They were asked to assess the development of track and field in Moscow on 4 criteria: scientific, methodical, quantitative and qualitative of science literature about training process, financial, funding of athletes and coaches, human resources, number of coaches in region and level of their knowledge, their skills, and logistical, availability of stadium and special equipment for training process. Results. This slide shows the percentage of prizes that athletes from Moscow held in Russian championships and athletics of various years. Total medals and medals different dignity: gold, silver, and bronze. As you can see, in the first half of the 20th century, athletes from Moscow demonstrate their rapid growth of sports result in the championship of the country. From 1950 to 1990, Moscow athletes rapidly lost their superiority on the Soviet arena due to high level of competition, due to high level of development track and field in our regions of our country. And it's quite logical that after Soviet Union's collapse, athletes from Moscow began to demonstrate the growth of sports advantage in the Soviet Russian arena again. These slides show the dynamic of performance of men and women at the same championships of the country. As can be seen from the graphs, women entered the competition a little later than men, and in the beginning of the second half of the last century, they won a few more medals than men. But the general trend is the same. The next slide presents the results of the expert assessment of development track and field in Moscow. the calculation of concordance coefficients show that experts agree that the most favorable period of development of track and field in Moscow is 1970 to 1990 on financial, logistical, and human criteria. However, disagreement arose about scientific methodical criteria, and they have real reasons. On the one hand, nowadays is much more scientific literature about training process. But on the other hand, what is quality of modern literature? One of our experts claims it's gone down. Ours do not agree. The questions, therefore, remains open. The findings were presented in the course of the report. Let me summarize them. The data obtained during the analysis of a championship of a country tell us about relative development of a track and field in Moscow. The data obtained during the expert assessment tell us about absolute development track and field in our region. This concept should be distinguished. During the maximum absolute development of athletics in Moscow, the level of its relative development was rather low. In this way, we can assert that the actual development of athletics in Moscow and our regions occurs only in the condition of high competition and the high level of development of this kind of sport in all our regions of our big country. Thank you for your attention.
Вопросы, пожалуйста, any questions, please?
You have told us about high performance sport, yes? And I would like to know how can the citizens of your city, of your region, be more motivated to do sports with being fit and healthy, maybe? And what should be done by the government in your region or maybe in our country in general?
Yeah, thank you for your question. Because it's very important to popularization of physical education, physical activity in our country. It's very difficult task. And as we know, nowadays government make a big steps in this direction. And it's connected with popularization of mass sport. And nowadays, a lot of competition in Moscow, in our region, in Russia, held in our country. And it's also very important that the physical education became very important subject of school curriculum. And in nowadays, government decided to increase the number of physical education lessons in the school. It also tells us about polarization in your question. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You may go. Смирнова Юлия Александровна. У нас должна быть готова следующий у нас выступающий Коренев Никита Алексеевич.
Hello, my name is Julia Smirnova. I'm from the Veliki Luki States Academy of Physical Culture and Sports. And today I'd like to tell you about the history of the sports movement in the Pskov region. The relevance of the topic is determined by the centenary of the foundation of the Supreme Council of Physical Culture, the successor of which is the Ministry of Sports of the Russian Federation, as well as executive authorities and the subjects of the Russian Federation, in particular the Pskov Provincial Council of Physical Culture. In connection with the centenary, it became necessary to create a short popular science essay on the history of the development of the sports movement in the Pskov region. The aim, scientific novelty, theoretical value, and practical significance you can see on the slide. The leading place in the system of pre-revolutionary education on the Pskov province was occupied by the Pskov main gymnasium. The merit in this belonged to the director of the gymnasium, Artur Jenikhovich Gottlieb. Under direct supervision of Gottlieb, the work of physical education of students was exemplarily carried out in Pskov men's gymnasium. On his initiative, two sports societies emerged, the Pskov Gymnastics Society Sokol and the Pskov Society of the Promotion of Physical Education of Students. Among the sports that have received primary development of the territory of the Pskov region, skiing and cycling, gymnastics can be distinguished. On the 1st of March 1936, the provisional rules on societies and unions were introduced, according to which local authorities were required to monitor the establishments and activities of societies and unions, including sports. The rapid organizational formation of the sports movement began, including in the Pskov province. In general, by 1970, there were 11 sports societies on the territory of the province. 10 societies exist in the provisional center, one each in Holm, Pechora, Apochka, and Zbizhanytsy. A special development in the Pskov region received the following sports. The revolutionary upheavals of 1917 and the outbreak of the civil war in Russia suspended the development of sports. However, their foundation laid in the late 19th, early 20th centuries was continued in Soviet times, but at a new level on a new ideological and organizational basis. After the end of the civil war, the All-Russian Central Executive Committee of the Russian Soviet Federative Socialist Republic on the 27th of June 1923 adopted the resolution of the establishment of the Supreme Council of Physical Culture under the All-Russian Central Executive Committee and its local bodies. In turn, the Pskov Provisional Council of Physical Culture was formed on the 28th of December 1923. When its first meeting took place, the Provisional Council was created to guide and coordinate the work on physical development by the workers of the Pskov province, to unite the departments involved in physical development in this work, as well as to control the implementation of all physical development measures. The technical committee consists of five sections: pedagogical and physical exercises, sports game, athletics and gymnastics, weightlifting, winter sports, and shooting sports. The Great Patriotic War played an important role in the life of many representatives of the physical culture and sports movements of the Pskov region in the second half of the 20th century. The severe trials of the war years hardened the character, taught them to overcome many life difficulties, which also affect the post-war phase of athletes, teachers, and organizers of physical culture and sports who achieve high results in their fields. Let's name just a few names. Бабкович Александр Антонович, Алексей Федорович Шабанов and Vladimir Mikhailovich Boytsov. In 1917, a branch of the Leskov Institute of Physical Culture and Sports was opened in Veliky Luki. During this 53 years history, Veliky Luki Sports Academy has gone from a branch to an academy, and during this time has trained more than 6,000 specialists to work in the field of physical culture and sports. The Museum of Sports and the Olympic Movement of the Pskov region, a structural subdivision of the Academy, has become the center of the preservation, study, and promotion of the regional history of physical culture and sports movement. The museum was opened in 2015. Native of the Pskov lands have made a significant contribution to the international sports and Olympic movement. They became winners, prize winners, and participants of the largest competition of our time. The winners of the Olympic Games are shown on the slide. And now conclusion. The most developed sports in the Pskov region including skiing and cycling, rowing, athletics and archery, which is confirmed by hard sports results in the competition of different levels. Pskov athletes continue the tradition of their predecessors, making a vast contribution to the development of the sports movements of the region, the country and the world. The list of used literature is shown on the slide. That's all. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Вопросы членам жюри?
Julian, are there any sports, aside from the ones that you have already mentioned, that are likely to be developed in the near future in Pskov?
Maya?
Yes. Yes.
No, I don't remember, but I study in service, but sports, it's not my future's job.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Спасибо. Никита Алексеевич, прошу вас. Следующий выступающий у нас будет Гудковская Антонина Тимофеевна. Подготавливайтесь, Антонина Тимофеевна.
Hello, everyone. The evolution of sport movement in OSCE in the 1960s into 1980 was organized through the activities of the country's government, trade union organization, a system of voluntary sports societies, and specialized sports schools. By 1970, there were 337 sport communities in the city, including 50 people as the members of the national teams of the Russian Soviet Federated Socialist Republic. 18 as the members of the national teams of the USSR, and more than 150 were the members of the national teams of voluntary sports societies. The city had 11 stadiums, more than 260 sport halls, and more than 1,000 different sport grounds, 53 shooting ranges, 96 skiing lodges, 109 hockey rinks, 46 swimming pools, 12 honor masters of sports of the USSR, more than 60 masters of international class, 1,500 masters of sports, and 37 honor coaches were from Omsk. In the 1960s to 1980, many sports were developing in Omsk and the region. One of the most popular team sports became volleyball, which began to develop rapidly in the educational institutions of the city in the 1960s. The purpose of the research is to study the evolution of volleyball in Omsk. Research objective is to reveal the formation of the sport movement in Omsk through the development of volleyball in the region. We use such research methods as historical, statistical, and generalization. Gurevich, the dean of the Omsk State Institute of Physical Education, and Razin, the head of the PA department of the Omsk State Pedagogical Institute, initiated volleyball at Omsk students. In 1965, the best volleyball players of the VSS Truth and the Children's and Youth Sports School Burevestnik were combined into the volleyball club Spartak and began to represent the Omsk region in all Republican and all union competitions. At the origins of the volleyball club Spartak, where the chairman of the regional council of the VSS Spartak, Galina Alexandrova Turashova, the head coach Vladimir Vasilyevich Shumakov, and regional sport committee Vitaly Konstantinovich Vysotsky. Since 1966, the team had taken part in USSR championships. In the 1976 to 1977 season, the team made its debut in the first league of the All Union Championship and performed there. In the 92 to 1993 season, Spartak took the first place in the Highest League B of the Russian Championship and got the right to increase the class. In 1994, it made its debut in the Highest Russian Women's Volleyball Division, where it took the fifth place. After the formation of the Super League, Spartak became the part of it, but only for two seasons. In 1997, the Omsk team took the last place in the Super League of the Russian Championship and dropped to the lower league. It returned to elite division in 1999 to 2000 season, but again taking the last place. They entered the Highest League A. In 2007, having won second place in the Highest League A, Omsk Spartak, after a long break, became the one of the best women's volleyball teams in Russia. Having a team of elite athletes taking part in Euro Cups in different years, the Omsk team met with the strongest clubs of Norway, Bulgaria, Spain, Switzerland, Turkey, Azerbaijan, Cyprus, Belgium, Holland, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Romania, Poland, Germany, France, and Italy. Due to conflict between the international sport organization Spartak and the Omsk team volleyball club Spartak, because of the brand, the club changed its name to Amishka in 2009. In 2015 to 2016 season, Amishka again lost its all K players due to financial crisis. Performances in the Super League of Russian Championship, the youth team of the club continued. For the world's name, the team had only one victory and became the last. At the end of the season, the club was declared bankrupt and ceased to exist. The main achievements of the club are bronze medalist of the Russian Championship, silver and bronze medalist of the Russian Cup, winner of the Cup of Siberia and the Far East, quarter finalist of the Champions League, and semi-finalist of the CEU Women's Cup. We would like to point out the OMS team has won the Cup of Siberia and the Far East 8 times, and this record has not been beaten yet. The head coaches of the Spartak volleyball team are presented on the slide. Over the years of performances in the team, there were 32 Masters of Sport, 3 European champions, 4 champions of the USSR, 7 silver medalists of the All-Union Spartakiades of the USSR, 7 bronze medalists of the World Universiade in Japan, 1 silver medalist of the All-Union School Spartakiade. The strongest players of the Spartak team for all the years of the performances are the following. Lubov Timofeeva is the Olympic champion in 1980, European champion in 1979, Honor Master of Sports of the USSR, winner of the USSR Cup in 1982. Anastasia Kadyrova is the silver medalist of the 2000 Olympic Games Honor Master of Sport. Anna Plyugunova is the captain of the Russian national team at the World Universiade in England and Japan, an iconic figure for Omsk volleyball. Lubov Kudryavtseva is a silver medalist of the Spartakiade of the Peoples of the USSR, the first master of sport in volleyball in Omsk region. Olga Ekimova is the champion of the USSR participant in the World Championship. It should be noted in our region there is an active development in such sports as hockey, basketball, football, athletics, motorcycling, fencing, handball, and many others. But volleyball deserves special attention, which in our opinion and the generalized material under study had an impact on the sport evolution norms. Thanks y'all for attention.
Спасибо. Вопросы?
So, thank you very much for your report, and I have a question. What are the prospects? What are the prospects for the movement of volleyball in Omsk region and other region?
Right now is a volleyball club, not Amichka. Right now is Om Rivers, because he got a financial crisis, and is it?
Okay, thank you.
Так, спасибо. Никита Алексеевич, какие-то жидкие у нас аплодисменты получились. Давайте повторим. Вот. А то Никита Алексеевич у нас не зря же галстук бабочку надевал. Аплодисменты заработал. А, так, пожалуйста, Антонина Тимофеевна Гудковская. И приготовится Шакирова Гуля Ринатовна.
Participants of the festival. My name is Gudkovska Antonina. The topic of the scientific work, Cycling Belarus, History and Modernity. The purpose is to analyze the historical aspects and current trends in cycling development in Belarus. Tasks: consider the history of cycling development on the territory of Belarus and analyze the current state of cycling and identify the most promising areas of its development. The historical experience and glorious exploits of fellow countrymen in the sports arena are important factors that will help us reach new heights in cycling and promote a healthy lifestyle, which underlines the relevance of this topic. Cycling Belarus has a rich history that reflects the general history of the country. The first bicycle appeared on the territory of Belarus in the late 1870s. The bicycle was perceived by contemporaries as the greatest invention of 19th century. It attracted people by its novelty, uniqueness, and dynamism. The first cycling competition were later held in Minsk in 1826. The first BSSR competition was held in Minsk in 1926. In 1930s, the first cycling clubs were created and multi-day races were held along routes running throughout the country. Since September 1939, the multiple winner of road and track races, a native of Brest, Nikolai Drancourt, has started participating in competition for Society Dinamarca. More than 50 pupils of Nikolai Vasilievich became prize winners of all union championship, and more than 200 distinguished themselves at Republican competition. In the post-war period, cycling continued developed despite difficulties and economic problems. It became more professional and organized in 1960s. Special bike trails and stadiums were created, as well as international competitions were held. There are Vladimir Kaminsky and Oleg Logvin, who became Olympic champions as a part of USSR team. Vladimir Kaminsky was a member of the quartet of Soviet athletes who won the team bicycle race in 1976 in Montreal. And he became a world champion as a part of USSR bicycle race on highway in 1977. Vladimir Kaminsky is one of the most famous and respected coaches in Belarus. Currently, he teaches at the Department of Cycling, Speed Skating and Equestrian Sport at the Belarusian State University of Physical Culture. Teachers and trainers of the department have a high level of knowledge and experience in the field of cycling, and they use modern teaching and training methods which allow them to achieve high results in cycling and competitions. The most promising areas of cycling development in Belarus currently include professional sport development, cycling tourism development, cycling infrastructure development, and cycling culture development. The Russian Cycling Federation, formed in 1992, played an important role in development in this direction in the Republic. Currently, the federation is managed by the Olympic bronze champion, eight-time world champion Natalia Celinska. Today, cycling is one of the most popular and developed sports in Belarus. In the recent years, Minsk has several times become the venue for the largest competition in cycling. On the initiative of federation, the first professional cycling club was created, Minsk Bicycle Club, in 2013. The European Track Cycling Championship was successfully held in Minsk Arena Velodrome in 2009. And the Republic of Belarus was entrusted with the right to host the most prestigious competition in the world of cycling, the Track Cycling World Championships in 2013. The competitions were held in the capital of the Republic of Belarus at a top level and were highly appreciated by International Cycling Union as well as participants and guests. In addition, the organization is engaged in the development cycling tourism and mass sports. Cycling is actively developing in children's and youth schools. In 2018, the national concept of the Department of Cycling was adopted in Belarus, which indicates that more attention has been paid for cycling at the state level. Bike routes often pass through city centers, picturesque and historical places make them more attractive for tourists. In particular, Yarovela 2, passing through Belarus, is called Route of Capitals, which includes 7 countries and 6 capitals. Currently, the cycling infrastructure is actively developing in the Republic. New bike paths are being built, bike garages are opening, rental points are appeared, and automatic Uber rentals are developing. Minsk is currently the leader of the development of cycling in the Republic in quantitative terms. The longest bike path in Minsk, 27 kilometers, opened in September 2009, across almost the entire city. The shared networks represented in Minsk have 3,000 bicycles and 300 electronic bicycles. Two most famous of them offer transport rental using mobile phone, to which you need to download a special application. Cycling culture is currently the main trend in the context of healthy and eco-friendly lifestyle, in order to foster citizenship and patriotism, as well to introduce healthy lifestyle. Regular sport and patriotic bike rides are organized. The day without car, free classes, cycling marathons, and races have become traditional. The Minsk International Cycling Carnival Viva Rover is the largest cycling event in Belarus, and annually attracts tens of thousands of people. Thus, cycling is a part of history of sports in Belarus and continues to be an important element of culture and public life. The state needs to continue to support the cycling development and culture, pursuing them not only as sport industry, but also as an effective means of forming a healthy lifestyle and patriotic education of young people. Every time I see an added bicycle, I no longer despair for the future of the human race. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Вопросы?
We have told us about the achievement in 1780s of the 20th century on Belarus athletes. And what can you tell us about the reasons, about the causes of such successful achievements of Belarus athletes in this period of the cycle? Why do you think it's so?
Because, thank you for your question. The development of cycling in the 60s and 70s more developed and organized, and a lot of prospective coaches, of course, due to his work and their work and professionalism, our athletes become Olympic champions.
And you have told us about it, and why do you think so cycling is so popular now in Belarus?
No, okay. Because it is maybe simple. We need only a bicycle. We have our free classes where you can taught how to use it. It is healthy and eco-friendly. You can go outside on the air, or I think it's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, sir. Thank you very much.
Спасибо. Антонина Тимофеевна может расслабиться. Айгуль Ринатовна, просим вас. И подготовится Юлия Валерьевна Федоренко.
Good morning. My name is Shakira Vaigul. It is a great honor for me to present my report on the topic, conditions for the formation and potential of digital sport development in Tatarstan. Today in the country, there is a trend towards digital transformation in various areas of life. There is a rapid growth in the use of the internet technologies, including digital games, which is presented in the pie chart. However, all this doesn't prevent the population of Tatarstan from actively engaging in physical culture. In this regard, in our republic, two areas like sports and digital technologies are reflected in the implementation of the digital sport. Therefore, the purpose of our study is to reveal the historical aspects of the formation of digital sports and its development potential in the Republic of Tatarstan. To begin with, it is worth clarifying what a digital is. This is a symbiosis of real sports and virtual in its various manifestations. For example, at the first Games of Future, digital sports competition, which will be held in Kazan in 2024, there will be 16 hybrid disciplines in 5 categories. Almost every discipline has a digital and physical part. Digital sport has gone through a short but eventful way of becoming an independent sport separate from esports. First of all, the preparatory stage was completed, indicated on the slide. In addition, both society and the state were interested in the development of this direction, and there was a need for regulatory consolidation, which we identified as an independent stage called the regulatory stage. Finally, we come to the practical implementation of these conditions. This sport is new, so the organizers needed to conduct test games in various disciplines. These test games will culminate in the Games of Future competition, which will take place in February 2024. The formation of digital sports, in particular the passage of all the historical stages that were indicated earlier, is influenced by a number of indicators and conditions that are presented on the slide. These are regulatory legal acts of federal and regional levels, infrastructure and sports facilities, the needs of the population, the prevalence of VR technologies and special equipment. Speaking about the needs of the population, it is important to note that in order to determine the involvement of the population of Tatarstan, in particular youth, in the direction of digital sports, we conducted a survey. In a diagram, we see that the majority is interested in the concept of digital sports, but does not know how to effectively introduce it into everyday life. In this regard, we have considered not only the historical aspects of digital sports, understanding the high potential of the digital direction, we presented a model for the development of digital sports in Tatarstan. It contains three basic components. As part of the substantive component, we focus on expanding the regulatory framework, implementing sports events, educational activities in educational organizations of various types and levels. However, at the same time, we propose to take a guideline not only for the realization of educational activities, but also include the social aspect of digital sports. In any case, the basis for the implementation of all these conditions is the availability of technical equipment. In the resultative component, we determine the qualitative indicators of the formation of conditions that were proposed in the second component, which you can see on the slide. As part of the implementation of the substantive part, to visualize the toolkit, we presented a schematic connection of each component. Specifically, it is necessary to focus on local acts, training of administrative and teaching staff, the availability of funding, technical equipment, and the creation of sanitary conditions. Thus, taking into account the analysis of the conditions and the potential for the development of digital sports, we can say that we are moving to a new level of development of sports and physical culture in the Republic of Tatarstan. The content and tools for the realization of the development of digital sports model can contribute to the effective organization of digital events and fully promote the introduction of this kind of sports in educational training processes within all educational organizations of different types and level. Thank you for your attention. I am ready to answer your questions.
Tell us, please, is it possible to form a digital sport as an adaptive sport, the sport for people with disabilities?
Oh,
and what sports event do you think should it be?
Thank you very much for this question. I am a future PE teacher, so I know about special groups at schools. Mm-hmm. And today, children with disabilities, they more and more. So I believe that digital, it is the perfect way for them to introduce in society and to somehow make physical achievements. Digital is inclusive sport, I believe, more inclusive than ours. So there is
maybe in the future you can
yes
we can have an adaptive sport event.
Yes, adaptive kind of sport in digital.
Thank you very much.
Спасибо. Эгуль Ринатовна, займите свое место в зале. Пожалуйста, Юлия Валерьевна Федоренко и готовится у нас Житков Дмитрий Станиславович.
Okay. Dear Mr. Chairman, the members of the conference committee, dear colleagues. Today, St. Petersburg is considered one of the centers of sports development in Russia. 159 events are practiced in our city, but only one of them had become a part of the Olympic movement, thanks to many coaches, athletes who worked really hard. Its traditions and techniques, which originated in our region, served as the foundation of many achievements in rhythmic gymnastics. However, there is a contradiction in the field of rhythmic gymnastics necessitating the importance of studying historical aspects of its development in St. Petersburg. On the basis of these observations, the object, the subject, and the main aim of the research have been determined. At the preliminary stage of the research, it was established that only 8% of the sports fans had been aware of the origins of rhythmic gymnastics as an Olympic sport.
It was established that at the end of the 19th and the beginning of 20th centuries, the main of rhythmic gymnastics was the unifications of several gymnastic schools, such as Delsarte aesthetic gymnastics, Delcroze rhythmic gymnastics, George Demeny women's gymnastics, and Isadora Duncan free dance. This heritage gained huge popularity in Russia from 1912 to 1929. Many gymnastic schools were open. That is how the Leningrad period of gymnastics started. Furthermore, in 1934, the heads of the most famous rhythmoplastic schools in country were invited to work at Lesgov State Institute of Physical Education. It's worth mentioning that the institute located near the outstanding centers of culture and art, such as Mariinsky Theater and the Rimsky-Korsakov State Conservatory. The same year, the Higher School of Artistic Movement was opened on the basis of the institute. Among the very first pedagogues were Varshavskaya, Nevinskaya, Semyonova, Naipak. Among the subjects of the curriculum were artistic movement, folk dances, and others. In 1939, the very first competition organized by pedagogues of Lesgov Institute was held. The same year, the first Leningrad Championship was held, the winner of which was Yulia Nikolaevna Shashkareva. Another very important achievement was the defense of the very first PhD thesis by Varshavskaya in 1936. In 1939, the first official rhythmic gymnastic championship was held in the USSR, the winner of which, Leningrad-born Lyubov Denisova. A dynamically developing new sport required methodological and regulatory support. During this period, the very first classification programs, as well as rules of competitions, were developed by specialists from Leningrad who published methodological literature. Gymnasts from Leningrad continued to win competitions across the Soviet Union. Among the names worth mentioning are Dina Agarodova, Valentina Sivohina, and Rima Pasnova. Many gymnasts who graduated from Lesgov Institute became heads of Department of Rhythmic Gymnastics at children's sports schools and clubs. It's worth mentioning that Lesgov University was not the only university making continuous contributions to the development of rhythmic gymnastics. In the 1950s, only 10 universities were practicing rhythmic gymnastics as a physical education activity. Nowadays, however, this number has increased to 40. The popularization of rhythmic gymnastics led to increase in professionalism of coaches and the number of talented gymnasts, as well as the creation of the national team. In 1963, the first international rhythmic gymnastics championship was held, and in 1984, rhythmic gymnastics gained the status of an Olympic sport. Rhythmic gymnasts from Leningrad have become European, world, and Olympic champions multiple times, continuing their career as honored coaches and judges. Having summed up all the historical facts, we have identified several factors which played the key role in gymnastics development. Among them are the organization of preparatory courses for gymnasts at children's sports schools and the Olympic reserve schools in St. Petersburg on a free of charge basis, and the sports clubs. The importance of these features is proven by the fact that the number of such sport organizations has significantly increased since 1940. The increase in number of rhythmic gymnastic coaches and judges, as well as the improvement of their professional skills, may also serve as the proof of the successful development of rhythmic gymnastics in the region. Over the course of the past 5 years, only sportsmen from St. Petersburg have won more than 60 medals at the international stage. They also win Russian championship every year and become members of Russian national Olympic team. Motivated to make their contribution to the development of rhythmic gymnastics, young athletes tend to prefer entering Lesgov University. Over the course of the last 4 years, only the number of highly qualified athletes who chose rhythmic gymnastics as their major has reached the number of 266, although the number of other regions has increased to 35. The graduates of Lesgov University are engaged in various activities aimed at increasing the popularity of rhythmic gymnastics. They work as coaches in St. Petersburg and all regions of Russia, leading the teams, representing them. It should also be noted that the most of PhD thesis dedicated to rhythmic gymnastics was defended at Lesgov by Lesgov specialists. It is 46%. Over the course of the past 10 years, they have published 30 textbooks and 292 research works. The methodological activities are playing the key role in the process of training highly qualified specialists who are on demand both in Russia and foreign countries. The continuously increasing number of tournaments being held in St. Petersburg confirms the tendency for the development of gymnastics in the region. Today, regardless of the development of international sports, St. Petersburg School of Gymnastics continues to evolve in new and diverse forms such as men gymnastics, pair gymnastics, duets, and trios. Thanks to the fusion of theatrical, musical, and choreographic art, as well as physical education and pedagogics, a new sport activity developing the human through rhythmic gymnastics was born in St. Petersburg and continues to evolve even today. Human memory is not everlasting, but it is our memory that creates traditions, allows one to understand and plan the trajectory of the positive development of any sport. We must not forget that modern gymnastics has achieved so much precisely because of the heritage of many generations. Thank you for your attention.
Спасибо. Члены жюри, вопросы?
Julian, we all know that it will be very difficult for many Russian rhythmic gymnasts to participate in international competitions in the near future. What is currently being done right now to ensure the steady development of rhythmic gymnastics in our country without the support from abroad?
Dear Professor, thank you for your question. Of course, we all know that nowadays we are surrounded by tough conditions from abroad. However, still coaches and athletes from all over the world come to Russia to train at our training camps. They look at us, they learn from us, and we should know that rhythmic gymnastics was born in St. Petersburg, in Russia. We should popularize it and be proud of it. And our main coach of Russian national team, Irina Vinarusmanova, makes a lot of effort to create new international tournaments.
Thank you.
Александр Александрович любит выключать микрофон. Юлия Валерьевна, спасибо. Thank you very much. Мы готовы послушать Дмитрия Станиславовича Житкова и готовится нас Гусев Максим Вадимович.
Dear jury, participants and guests, we invite your attention to a report on the topic, the dependence of the effectiveness of training Olympians in Voronezh sports schools on the number of students. Voronezh region is a generous land. Our land has brought up many talents, and we are proud that the first Russian champion of the modern Olympic Games was a native of the Voronezh region. His name was Nikolai Panin Kolominkin, and he became the Olympic champion in figure skating at the 1908 Games in London. Relevance. Every region of our great country is proud of its Olympians. Voronezh also has its record holders, 28 champions and prize winners of the Olympic Games in various sports. Dozens of sports schools, hundreds of coaches have been working to educate them. They prepare a new generation of young athletes. The more children come to sports, the more champions appear. It is with this statement that our work is connected. The research touches upon training of highly qualified athletes, Olympic medalists. The hypothesis of the research sounds as follows: the effectiveness of training is in direct proportion to the number of people involved in this sport. The object of the research is the tendencies of educating highly qualified athletes. The subject of the research is retrospective statistics of the number of athletes in sports institutions of Voronezh and the effectiveness of their training. And the purpose of the study is to extract trends in the number of athletes in sports institutions of Voronezh and the effectiveness of their training. research objectives. Firstly, to analyze information sources, taking into consideration the number of highly qualified Olympic athletes in Voronezh. Secondly, to create a ranking of Voronezh sports institutions which brought up Olympic champions. And thirdly, to reveal the relationship between the number of athletes in sports institutions of Voronezh and the number of Olympians. Organization of research. The study was carried out on the basis of the Voronezh State Sports Academy. The research methods used: analysis, ranking, and survey. Research stages. Stage number one was devoted to the development of hypotheses, goals, and objectives of the study. Stage number two was aimed at working with information sources and archival materials, developing a questionnaire for interviewing coaches. And stage number three comprised summing up the research results and writing a report. The novelty of the research lies in the extension of knowledge about the trends and factors affecting the education of highly qualified athletes. Research results. On the basis of analysis of information sources, we determined that since 1960, Voronezh citizens have become Olympic champions. There are 39 sports institutions and about 80 sports federations in Voronezh. They provide sports training for children and youth, both for health promotion and for building future sports career. In the course of this research, 7 sports institutions of Voronezh, which brought up Olympic champions and prize winners in 7 kinds of sports, were identified. Table 1 shows the number of people engaged in sports institutions of Voronezh in the year of Olympic records and at present. The data show that there is no correlation between the number of people involved in sports and the training of highly qualified athletes. Thus, our hypothesis wasn't confirmed. However, a survey of coaches helped to explain the absence of the studied relationship. The results of the survey are given in table number 2. Thus, the results of the study showed that the number of people involved in sports isn't such a significant factor in the training of highly qualified athletes. There are more important factors that influence the effectiveness of sports training. And now, I invite you to watch a film about the Voronezh athletes. Here you can see places of interest and the achievements of the Voronezh sports. Thank you for your attention. The report is over, and now I'll be glad to answer your questions.
Даже захотелось в Воронеж. Вопросы, пожалуйста. Пойдем.
Dmitry Stanislavovich, thank you for your report and answer to the question. What causes the gradual increasing in the number of students enrolled in sports schools in your region? Increasing.
Do you mean another trend that influences?
Increasing of number students enrolled in sport clubs or is in sport schools. What causes that?
Что способствует повышению количества вовлеченных? Вот вы говорите, да, там о статистике какой-то. О том, что повышение, увеличение количества занимающихся.
So our hypothesis wasn't confirmed. Wasn't confirmed. So, because let me show the slide. With table number 2. So we interviewing coaches, and that table shows that there is no correlation between of people involved in the opinion of coaches. Let me show the table number one. So here we can see that the number of people doesn't mean better, doesn't mean more Olympic champions. Our hypothesis wasn't confirmed.
Thank you.
Спасибо, Дмитрий Станиславович. Максим Владимирович, пожалуйста. Подготовится Анне Владимировне Виноградовой.
Good afternoon, everybody. The evolution of sports in the Kuban. Zvam and hospitable Krasnodar region in recent years has been a leader in Russia in the development of sports movement. The relevance, the aim, and the tasks of the study and also the methods are presented on the slides. The analysis of the material showed that a lot of work is being done in the region to promote sports and the target program, development of mass sports in the Kuban, has been adopted. First of all, I'd like to stress that based on the results of the year 2019, within the framework of the National Sports Award competition, our region was among the top three regions for the development of physical culture and sports. However, one must understand that the development of sports in Krasnodar territory has deep historical roots. In the distant 1902, the first society of gymnastics and cycling enthusiasts was set up in the capital of the Kuban. In 1912, the Achilles Society and the Dynamo Stadium were opened in Yekaterinodar, now Krasnodar, which marked the beginning of the development of athletics. A huge role in the evolution of the sports movement was played by the sport club, created in 1913 in the capital of the Kuban on the initiative of the sports enthusiast Yakov Arakelov. At the beginning of the 20th century, the Kuban became passionately interested in the English game, football. In 1928, the Krasnodar City football team Dynamo was founded, which 20 years later became the champion of Russia. In the middle of the 20th century, a unique tradition was launched in the region, the running, swimming, relay races along the Kuban River and two seas, the Azov Sea and the Black Sea. This popularized the swimming sport. It is natural that in 1952, the team of the Krasnodar territory won the title of the champion of the Russian Republic in swimming. The Krasnodar territory has its own traditional sports in which local athletes and coaches set the tone not only in their own country, but also in the world. Some brightest stars. Runner Ludmila Bragina is called the icon of the Kuban sports. It was she who brought the first Olympic gold to the Kuban from the 1972 Olympics in Munich, where she set a world record three times. Vitaly Dubko is the best trampolining coach of the 20th century, according to the official title of the International Gymnastics Federation. Back in 1976, his pupils Evgeny Yanis and Evgeny Yakovenko won the World Championship in trampolining, which was held in the United States. Six gold medals were then won by Soviet athletes, of which three medals came to Krasnodar. In 2000, when trampoline jumping was taken in the Olympic program, Alexander Moskalenko and Irina Karavaeva from Krasnodar became the first Olympic champions. Moskalenko was included in the Guinness Book of World Records for the number of victories at World Championships, 14 victories. Slide 10 shows the results of the participation of Kuban athletes in the Olympic Games from 1952 to 2016. The 2000 Olympics in Sydney was the most successful for the Kuban athletes. Then a significant victory for the Kuban was won by the Russian men's handball team, a large part of which were natives of the Krasnodar territory. It is impossible not to mention the 24th Olympic Winter Games in the subtropical city of Sochi that were unique in many ways and accelerated the development of the sports movement in the Kuban. Top-class sports facilities made the foundation for winter sports popularization. New sports facilities have sprung up in the Kuban. in accordance with the National Project Demography and the Regional Project Sport is a Life Norm, 25 new sports facilities are to be built in the Kuban in 2023. All cultivated sports in the region are successfully developing today. Thus, last year, the team of the Krasnodar territory won the overall standings in the trampoline competitions of the Southern and North Caucasian federal districts with a big advantage. The Krasnodar Sports Club of Acrobatics and Trampolining, named after Vasily Machuga, is considered the strongest in the country. Now about handball. In 2022, pupils of the Krasnodar Regional Handball School became bronze medalists of the All-Russian competitions for juniors. The Kuban men's handball team won a victory at the All-Russian University in 2022. I'd like to stress that about 300,000 school children from 709 secondary schools of the region are involved in Sambo within the framework of the project Sambo for School. It is very important that the administration of the Krasnodar territory annually allocates over 10 billion rubles from the regional budget for the development of physical culture and sports. Today, about 3 million people are actively involved in sports in the region. For more than 50 years, Kuban State University of Physical Education, Sports and Tourism has been a forge of sports personnel. During the years of its activity, it has trained about 40,000 highly qualified professionals. In conclusion, I'd like to attract your attention to the novelty, practical and theoretical relevance of the research presented on the slides. Novelty in the course of the research, the scientific, historical, and memoir literature was studied, analyzed, and summarized. The materials of the historical archive of the Krasnodar territory were used, some of which were introduced into scientific use for the first time. Theoretical and practical relevance are presented on the slides. Thank you for your attention.
Спасибо, Максим Владимирович. Вопросы?
Максим, thanks to your report, we now know what sports, what events are popular in your region. For example, handball, sambo, and many others. But there is something that I would like you to clarify. Why these particular sports? What makes them specifically so popular and so important for many people among the citizens of your region? Why is this happening?
I must say about handball or
about any kind of sport you consider important, or maybe more important than others, or maybe all of them if you want.
Okay. Thank you for your attention. Actually, yes, in our region is popular football, handball, volleyball, a lot of kind of sports, winter sports too, bobsleigh, biathlon, ice hockey, figure skating. Why it is popular? I think we have really a lot of sport facilities, sport objectives for this kind of sports. For example, what about football? It's FK Football Club Krasnodar. You know that it's a big area for the development of this kind of sport. What about in other sports? For example, bicycle. It's really good climate for this, you know. What about volleyball? In our university, Kuban State University of Physical Education, Sport and Tourism, it's too a lot of facilities for volleyball, martial arts, what else? Basketball, of course, and handball. I think if I can understand only one task, we have a lot of sport facilities for a lot of kinds of sport.
And for you, the abundance of sports facilities is the most important factor, correct?
For me, actually, one kind of sport, or what?
No. Do you think that the abundance of sports facilities and the abundance of sports facilities is the most important factor, which is related to the popularity of, for example, handball and all the other sports you've mentioned?
Yes, I think it's really important, but we must understand that we have a lot of Olympic champions, we have a lot of good sportsmen, which have a big weight in sport. And children look at this and seeing that, I want to be similar on this sportsman. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you too.
Спасибо. Спасибо. Анна Владимировна Виноградова. И подготовиться к Карпову Виталию Максимовичу.
Hello, my name is Anna Vinogradova. I'm the student of the State Academy of Physical Education and Sport, and I want to present you a report on the topic, the development of novice in the Perm region. Currently, more new and exciting sports are developed. One of them is novice, the Latvian national sport. Novice began to be played in the Perm region a few years ago. Therefore, we decided to study the history of the sport and draw people's attention to the game of novice. The research purpose is to study the novice game development in the Perm region and to assess the impact of novice classes on the movement accuracy. The research objectives are to study the origin and development of novice, its popularity in different countries, including Russia and the Perm region, and to evaluate the novice class's impact on the movement accuracy. In 1927, a sailor from Latvia, Andris Nadorski, set sail to the shores of Hong Kong. In one of the pubs, he saw a billiard-like game playing on a square table with sides and pockets in the corners, into which players knocked flat wooden discs with finger strokes. Returning to his homeland, Andrew decided to make a similar table, but playing he used a small cue stick. Thus, a new game was born. In the beginning, novice was played in the cities of Latvia and Estonia, then it spread further. 5 years later, the official rules of the game appeared and the first competitions were held. The beginning of international competitions was laid in 2003, when a team from St. Petersburg represented Russia at the first European Championship. In 2008, the International Federation of Novice was established and the World Cup stages were approved. Novice is a game similar to billiard, but unlike it, the table for novice is smaller, the equipment is cheaper. Men and women of all ages, people with different abilities, healthy people and people with special needs can play the game in the same conditions. The main idea of the game is to strike all pucks into the pockets and to get the fewest penalties. In Russia, the first Novice Federation appeared in St. Petersburg in 1999. Then, Novice began to be played in other cities. You can see the regional federation of Novice in our country. Two of them are in the Perm region. The Novice Federation of the Perm Krai was established in 2015. The main activity of the federation is the popularization and development of the Novice game in the Kama region. The Novice Federation of Disabled People of the Perm Krai was founded in March 2020. Its goal is to involve people of different categories in sport. It supports inclusion for people with special needs. Today, various novice tournaments are held in the Perm region. According to the results of the third stage of the Perm Krai League competition, Pavel Kuchumov, Alexander Tokarev, and Radik Seyfedinov became the leaders among men. And among women, Lyubov Kurochkina ranked first, Maria Chvizgalova was the runner-up, and Olga Glukhova took the third place. The big event was the holding of the first stage of the Russian Novice Cup in Perm. 15 athletes represented our region. After watching the results, we can see that Olga Glukhova is a silver medalist of the competition, who represented our Perm region. On February the 1st, 2022, our town became one of the venues for novice events. The Tchaikovsky Organization of the Disabled People won the regional grant competition with the social project We Can Do Everything. The goal of the project is the integration into society of people with disabilities through adaptive novice classes. During the project, the students of our academy acted as novice trainers. In this regard, we decided to study how useful and effective novice training is for those involved. The study involved 15 students from our academy. The research was conducted from February 1, 2022 to April 1, 2023. To assess the movement accuracy, we performed three tests at the beginning and at the end of the training process. During the first test, the players used 8 direct strikes to attack pucks. The task of the second test was to pocket pucks with 8 rebound strikes. And the third test was to make 8 strikes to attack the striker from its various positions. Comparing the test findings, we received the following results. It shows that the differences at the beginning and at the end of the study are significant. The number of hits has increased, which means that the stroke accuracy has improved. In the course of our research, we have learned that novus is a sport which is becoming more and more popular in the Perm region. Today, various tournaments are held there. And also, we have come to conclusion that novus training has a positive effect on the development of movement accuracy. Thus, we believe that it's necessary to continue spreading the sport. We would like many people to join this movement, so we invite everyone to play novus. And now I can show you a video about novus. Attention, I'm ready to answer your questions. Thank you for the question. I think it is important to spreading the sport, and we can include the sport in different groups of population in our city. For example, for disabled people, for blind people, for people with physical disabilities, we can hold different tournaments for these people and different festivals.
Виталий Максимович приглашается, а Вильсон Даниэль готовится.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. So I'm very glad because I see your happy faces, and it's a great pleasure to present you the very exciting presentation about my native region of Chelyabinsk in sports. And first of all, I would like to say that Chelyabinsk region is one of the most sports powerful regions in Russia, because we have the great sports history, traditions, schools, coaches, and athletes, of course. So excuse me, next slide. The Eurostate University of Physical Culture is based in Chelyabinsk. Today, this is not just the only sports university in the Urals, but also a wound metallurgical center for sport, physical culture, and recreational work in the Ural Federal District and adjacent regions. I would like to present one of the most popular sports in our region is the ice hockey. We have two ice hockey clubs which have membership in the Continental Hockey League. And the first is the Traktor Chelyabinsk Ice Hockey Club. This club was established in 1947, and since 2009, our city got the modern Traktor Ice Arena. This venue hosted a lot of global sport events, but I would like to talk about this later. Also, we have the Metallurg Ice Hockey Club in Magnitogorsk City. This club won the Gagarin Cup twice, and the Metallurg also has the modern ice venue. The next sport which has the big popularity in our region is judo. The history of the South Ural judo also passes from the beginning of the 70s of the last century. In 1970s, the Chelyabinsk coach, Mr. Haris Yusupov, organized the first judo section. The Yusupov's most titled athletes is Mr. Grigory Verichev. The Chelyabinsk judo has a lot of successful athletes. It's, for example, Mr. Vitaly Makarov and also Mr. Mansur Isaev, London 2012 Olympic champion. In 2004, the Olympic Judo Training Center was opened in Chelyabinsk. It embodied the dreams of all generations of the famous South Ural Judo School. The next popular sport in the Chelyabinsk region is Taekwondo. Taekwondo, for the less than 25 years of its existence in the South Ural, has passed a long way of formation and development. Having originated in the Soviet era, Taekwondo was officially established in the early 19th of the last century in the Chelyabinsk region. Took root and after some time turned into the center of the development of the sport in Russia. It was the Chelyabinsk region that became the first in the country to rise an Olympic medalist, the first world champion to organize the first international ranking tournament for the Olympics and to host the best ever world championships. Taekwondo in the Chelyabinsk region has acquired promising and recognizable names and faces all over the world. The Chelyabinsk Taekwondo has a lot of successful athletes. It's Anastasia Baryshnikova, Olga Ivanova, and Tatiana Min. The Chelyabinsk local organizing committee has held more than 20 international sport events. A few years ago, many international sports officials didn't know such a region as Chelyabinsk. Today, we are well known to a meteorite and various international competitions which were held at an excellent level. But I would like to talk about the key global sport events in the Chelyabinsk history. In 2014, the World Judo Championships were held in Chelyabinsk. After successful 2012 European Championships, the International Judo Federation made a decision to host this flagship event in the South Ural capital. These championships assembled more than 700 athletes from 118 participating countries. The local organizing committee got from the IGF officials the mark as the best world championships ever. In 2015, the World Taekwondo Championships were held in Chelyabinsk. This event had the 872 athletes from 140 participated countries. This World Championships became the historical event because the first time in Taekwondo history, the South and North Korean demonstration teams performed on one Dojang together. The World Championships, the World Taekwondo also given the mark as the best World Championships ever, and this championships received a lot of good comments from the President of Russia, United Nations Secretary General, the IOC President, and World Taekwondo President. Finally, I would like to say that in accordance of sport called Global Sports Portal, Chelyabinsk region was included in the top 150 of World Sport Host ranking. Being a member of organizing committees of these both World Championships, I could say that Chelyabinsk region really could be one of the sport capitals in Russia. Thank you for your attention.
Спасибо. Пожалуйста, вопросы.
You could talk just about high performance sport, yes? And I would like to ask you about fast sport, about sport for all.
Yeah.
And what competitive sports are offered by different gyms, health clubs in your region? And what do you think about it?
So thank you for your question. So what about the sports for all? We have a lot of gyms and sports clubs for all categories of our citizens. These clubs have big popularity in our city and our region. So what about the sport for all in these sports? I could say about the Taekwondo school, we have the a lot of prizes as the best school sports school in Russia, because we have the a lot of children. It's about 1,000, 1.5 thousand of children.
And what competitive sports are offered by different health clubs? I think maybe basketball, tennis, racquetball.
I could say about the basketball, we have some the so we have the special maybe I understand. So we have the special program of our Ministry of Sports for development of any kind of sports, and we have a lot of venues, the street venues for the sports, for example the basketball. We have a lot of venues in our city.
Спасибо, Виталий Максимович. Приглашается Бейлинсон Даниэль, а готовится нас Лунина Анастасия Юрьевна.
Hello everyone, and let me present you the history of sport movement in Moscow region. Vitality. It is impossible to separate the history of the small motherland from the history of the whole country. After all, the history of sports in Russia was reflected in the history of Little Malakhovka. The reforms in Russian society after historical and critical changes of the 90s could not but affect radically all the system of physical culture and sports at the regional level. The deterioration of economic conditions, destruction of methodological potential and material base of physical culture led to the decline both of elite sports and mass physical sports in the country. To solve this problem, new organizational solutions are necessary to create an effective system of organizing sports and recreational work among the population. It is high time to generalize our national experience accumulated by Russian and Soviet scientists and practitioners in this respect. That's why we have made an effort to study the achievements of the previous generations in organizing physical culture and sports system at our region. Thus, a retrospective analytic review was made to understand the general trends in the development of physical culture and sports at Moscow regional level in the 18th, 20th centuries. On such basis, recommendations can be developed to improve the activities of the local physical culture and sports organizations. As you know, our academy is located in the picturesque place of Malakhovka. That's why we have based our research on the materials of well-known ethnographers about Moscow province, closest to Malakhovka. Malakhovka was the part of the Bronnitsa County in the 19th century was marked by the rapid growth of industrial enterprises, including those in Moscow province. In order to improve the physical form of workers and distract them from bad habits, the owners of factories began to create sports clubs. One of the leaders here was the village of Raminskaya of the Bronnitsa County. In 1871, the School of Trade and Industrial Association Malutin and Sons opened a gym at the school. Gymnastics began to be taught at the Malutin School. It was for the first time in the entire Moscow province. For some decades, the gym turned into the factory sports club. Thus, in 1914-1915, Malutin Club built a football field with an athletics court and a pavilion, grounds for lawn tennis, croquet, and the bowling alley, a roller coaster with bends, several bathhouses, and a boat station on Borisoglebskaya Lake in Raminskaya. Moscovites interested in sports activities used to spend summer months in the countryside. They turned the summer holiday villages of Malakhovka, Ilinskaya, Raminskaya, Bykova into the centers of sports. The vast majority of cities in the Russian Empire could envy the sports base of Malakhovka. There were such sports facilities on the Lake Estate area as a cyclodrome, two skating rinks, bicycle rental, a state station of Moscow Motorist Society, a bowling alley, a shooting gallery, and a boat station. Cross-country relay race Malakhovka-Moscow was held with the start in Malakhovka. Lake Estate was a place of attraction for famous writers, poets, and artists. The host, writer Nikolai Teleshov, was the organizer of Teleshov's Wednesdays, with which gathered all the Moscow Bohemia in Malakhovka. They had a nice time not only discussing and composing, but also doing sports. At his expense, the children of the poorest peasants and workers from the area were educated. With his direct participation, the very first in Russia gymnasium for joint education of boys and girls was built in Malakhovka. By the way, the concept of physical education was first mentioned in the report of the principal of the Malakhovka Gymnasium, Zenchenko, in 1910. and at the territory of Lake Estate, our academy was settled in 1931. From here, the history of Moscow State Academy began. In May 1931, the Moscow Regional Executive Committee and the Moscow Department of National Education made the decision to organize the Department of Physical Education at the Teachers Training College. In 1933, the Teachers Training College was transferred into Moscow Regional College of Physical Education, and in 1994, it became Moscow State Academy of Physical Education. It was glorious and heroic history. Together with the country, teachers and students of our academy overcame all the difficulties and hardships associated with the pre-war and war years. During four war years, the best coaches taught future soldiers how to conduct hand-to-hand combat, throw grenades, overcome obstacles, and skiing at military training centers and stadiums. After the war, already in 1945, the first post-war football cup of the region was held, in which 12 teams participated. In the mid-50s, up to 500,000 athletes participated in competitions. The first international achievements came to Moscow region athletes, when mass summer and winter starts became popular. The Yuri Gagarin Memory Run in Sholkovo, a series of runs in Korolev, a half marathon in Pushino, a daily run in Podolsk, a run on Znamensky Brothers in Ramenskoye are known, and more than 26,000 people have participated in the ski track of Russia this year. The concept of sports moving promoting in Moscow region has been developed up to 2024. New, higher requirements for the quality of training of the sports organization in Moscow region have been presented. In the recent years, a big step forward has been made in Moscow region in creating the necessary conditions for the formation of an effective system of physical education and the development of physical culture and sports. However, the development of mass occupations is hindered by objective and subjective factors. We have found out that the entire pre-revolutionary sports history of our country and our region in the absence of state support was a history of loners. Sports were only available to the elite. The working class did not have a wide access to sports. Physical culture and sports rested on the enthusiasm of progressive personalities and the support of patrons. Progressive organization of physical culture and sports movement in post-revolutionary Russia, state progressive reforms of sport developing, state support programs have turned the country into undeniable leader in international sports over several decades. Thus, a respectful and creative attitude to the experience of sports movement organization in the USSR, individual initiatives of pre-revolutionary progressive researchers in the field of physical culture and sports could be invaluable in creating an effective sports movement organization in our country and in our region. Thank you for your time.
Спасибо. Даниэль, вопросы?
Daniel, thank you. Daniel, according to your report, many famous writers, poets, and artists used to visit the academy in Malakhovka a lot in order to, well, discuss various problems and topics related to sports. In your opinion, should writers, poets, or I don't know, maybe journalists, try to be engaged in popularizing sports these days more often? Will this particular practice be efficient in solving the problems you have mentioned? What do you think?
Well, in my opinion, any famous and, if I can say, valuable person can and have to show interest in sports and make it more popular for the children and for the people that don't have the ability to play any sport they like. And if these persons have the ability to provide them that opportunity, I think they have to.
Thank you so much.
Спасибо. Ждем Анастасию Юрьевну на трибуну. Анастасия Юрьевна уже подходит. И готовится нас, от не знаю, куда дали листаясь, но рискну поставлю на первый слог, Томская Надия Вячеславовна. Не знаю, ошибся, не знаю, нет.
dear Chairman and dear members, a significant contribution to the development of the physical culture movement in the Far East of the country was made by universal education. The main result was that under the leadership of the general education, the first physical education asset was created, which later joined the ranks of Far East sports society, including Dynamo. We have found very few scientific papers devoted to the topic, the history of physical culture on the Russian Far East. Therefore, the above highlights the relevance of our work. The object is the history of the development of physical education in the Russian Far East. The subject is the proletarian sports society Dynamo in the Far East of Russia. The purpose of this project was to study the organization and formation of the proletarian sports society Dynamo in the Russian Far East. In the course of the research, the following tasks were solved. First, to study the history of the creation of the proletarian sports society Dynamo in Russia. And second, to study the development of the proletarian sports society Dynamo in the Far East of Russia. The practical and theoretical significance you can see in this slide. In March 1923, a project was developed to create a sports society of the troops of the Moscow garrison. The name of the society was chosen Dynamo, which means force and motions. The first constituent meeting of the new sports society was held in April 18, 1923, in the circus building on Tsvetnoy Boulevard. Uralets was the founder of the Moscow Proletarian Sports Society Dynamo, and Unschlich was elected the first chairman of Dynamo. An emblem depicting the attributes of 11 sport was approved. The flag and colors of the society were chosen. It was decided to choose blue and white colors for the society. The first emblem didn't last long until 1926, then the famous Dynamo emblem appeared, a white rhombus in which the letter D is enclosed. The first result of the company activity was signed up on October 8, 1923. In the same year, in May, the first football team was created in Moscow. In September 1923, the issue of creating sections of the Dynamo Society in remote cities of the country, following, for example, Moscow, was considered. On October 8, 1924, the creation of regional branch of the Dynamo under the local administration was announced. In the Far East of Russia, the first regional Dynamo Society appeared in Khabarovsk, the capital of the Far East Regional. In the newspaper Working Day, there was a small note: in the near future, the proletarian sports society Dynamo will be organized in Khabarovsk. On December 1924, Alexander Alpov, the representative for the Far East Regional, signed an order on the establishment of the Far East Regional Council, and Alpov himself became its first chairman. The minutes of the Constituent Assembly of the Far East Regional Council of the Dynamo were sent to Moscow and approved in April 1925. Dynamo was perceived by the Far East public as an organization that, under the leadership of the Far East Regional Council of Physical Education, would develop methods of mass involvement for Eastern workers in sport and for physical culture, except for organizing for activities at factories. The branch of the Dynamo Sports Society in Primorye began its activity in early 1925. In the same year, the first Dynamo organization in Sakhalin Island. In Blagoveshchensk and Nikolaevsk-on-Amur, branch of the Proletarian Sports Society Dynamo appeared at the end of the 1924. The first activists who will be in Dynamo Society in 1924 were Karpenko, Pertsov, Muzykan, Chernyshov. And the first woman to become a member to Dynamo in the Far East is Ananieva, an athlete from Khabarovsk. To achieve maximum efficiency, all types of physical exercise were divided into sections. Initially, Dynamo's work was concentrated in such sections: athletics, gymnastics, football, basketball, chess, defense and attack without weapons, fencing, shooting, and a section of winter sport, like speed skating, hockey, cross-country skiing, and other. The sports work was seasonal. In summer, members of the society were engaged in athletics, games, swimming. In the winter, it was skiing, gymnastics, wrestling, playing bandy. since 1st of February 1925, athletes who showed the best result were awarded with a special prize, a silver badge of the Dynamo Society. In March 1925, the first intercity competition with the Vladivostok national team were organized and held. There were already 621 Dynamo societies operating in the Far East region, United 7,000 people. Therefore, the Proletarian Sports Society Dynamo in the 1920s made a huge contribution to the development of physical culture in the most remote region of the country. Thank you for your attention.
Спасибо, Анастасия Юрьевна. Вопросы? Пожалуйста.
Анастасия, maybe can you remember and name the name principles of this movement? Maybe they are or they have big importance nowadays, currently. Principles, the main principles of this movement.
I don't remember principles of this movement. Maybe force and motions, or motions.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
Спасибо. Спасибо, Анастасия Юрьевна. Поаплодируем Анастасии Юрьевне и ждем Надежду Вячеславовну. Готовится у нас Перепелицына Светлана Андреевна.
Hello, dear Commission and participants of the festivals. The reason I'm here today is to talk to about the role of personality in the development of physical education in the Republic of Саха Якутия. The population of Yakutia had no idea about physical culture in its modern sense, about sports in its classical form before the great October Socialist Revolution. The lack of personnel in the industry caused great difficulties in the early years of the development of the physical culture movement in Yakutia. You can see the relevance of our work on the screen. In the year of 100th anniversary of the formation of the state governing body in the field of physical culture and sports, we would like to identify the stages of development and formation of physical education in Yakutia, as well as to note the personalities who have made a significant contribution in this direction based on a review of academic and scientific sources. Until 1931, there was not a single employee with a higher education in the field. Instructors worked either who had absolutely no physical education or who had no completed training courses for instructors in Moscow and Leningrad. Therefore, the top management made attempts to train their personnel to meet the demands of the growing physical culture movement. In 1927, a special program was developed that was available to ordinary teachers of rural schools who were supposed to be charged with conducting physical education lessons. An important role in the formation and development is played by their own national professionally qualified personnel. The issue of personnel training has always been given special attention. Omsk and Central Institute of Physical Education played a big role in this. With the opening of the Yakut State Pedagogical Institute in 1934, physical education classes were included along with general education subjects. However, at first they did not find a specialist in this subject. It was only in 1935 that Evgeny Kuzmich Sorovetsky, an instructor of the Yakut Council of Physical Culture, was accepted as the first teacher. The main task then was to introduce physical education and sports. The academic part of physical education was given 2 hours a week. In October 1935, Yakov Maximovich Arzhakov was accepted as a part-time physical education teacher. He is the first graduate with a higher physical education, graduated in 1932 from the Central Institute of Physical Education in Moscow. Yakov Maximovich began his work with the creation of a material base. In 1937, Nikolai Stepanovich Maslov, a graduate of the State Central Lenin Medal Institute of Physical Education, was admitted to the Pedagogical Institute. He worked during the Great Patriotic War, which radically changed the program of physical education. In the country and in the Republic, Siobuch was announced. In this regard, mass military physical training has become of paramount importance in physical education. In the post-war years 1945-1953, the ranks of physical education teachers were replenished with new personnel. Until 1953, only a few dozen public instructors and sports referees were training annually, but in subsequent years, the number increased significantly. An important role in the training of personnel was played by the opening of the Department for the Training of Physical Culture Specialists in 1952 at the Yakutsk Pedagogical College. The main task of the new department was to train teachers of physical culture of a wide profile. Tatiana Leonidovna Sinyavina was appointed the first head of the department. Owning almost sports, she organized club section competitions. 4 years later, in 1956, the Physical Education Department of Yakut Pedagogical College graduated 13 specialists of physical culture. Belyuysky Pedagogical College, named after Chernyshevsky, the oldest professional educational institution of Yakutia, was founded in 1922 at the Belyuysky Pedagogical College on the initiative of the director of the school, Mikhail Spiridonovich Ivanov, and the Ministry of Education of the USSR. A physical education department was opened in 1968. In 1971, the department graduated 27 young specialists, teachers of physical culture. In 1989, the Yakut Republican Schools of the Olympic Reserve was opened in two sports, freestyle wrestling and boxing. Alexander Mikhailovich Bratishev, a graduate of the Omsk State Institute of Physical Education, was appointed director of the Olympic Reserve School in January 1990. The next stage in the development of physical education was 1996, when the Faculty of Physical Education and Sports was opened at the Pedagogical Institute. Nikolai Kalinovich Shamaev was appointed the first head. The faculty includes four departments. In 1999, the faculty received a new status, the Institute of Physical Culture and Sports. In 1994, on the initiative of Guliaev Mikhail Dmitrievich, a branch of the Physical Education Department of the Yakut Pedagogical College No. 1 was opened. The educational process was organized in the form of intensive training in the basis of the Yakut Pedagogical College No. 1 and in shifts. About 100 graduates of the branch received a diploma physical education teacher. In 1999, the Cherepchinsky Institute of Physical Culture and Sports was opened on the basis of the branch. Now it is the only federal university of the Ministry of Sports of Russia dealing with the problems of training specialists in the field of national sports. Along with Institute of Physical Education and Sports or Northeastern Federal University and secondary specialized institutions, we have achieved that 20 years ago there were 36% of specialists with higher education in the field of sports. In 1990, these figures increased exactly 2 times 72%. According to the latest data from the Yakut Ministry of Physical Culture and Sports, there is a positive trend in the share of the population of the Republic Saha-Yakutia, systematically engaged. Based on the study of equivalent materials and the works, domestic physical education in Yakutia can be discussion. During the period of formation and development of professional physical education in Yakutia, a number of change and reforms took place in the structure and status educational institution. But positive dynamics and further development would be impossible without the role of each of the heads of educational institutes they mentioned. Vision of the future, enthusiasm, sports spirit allowed to enrich and multiply the history of the sports movement of the Republic of Saha-Yakutia with bright victories. Thank you for your attention.
Спасибо, Надежда Вячеславовна. Вопросы?
Uh-huh. Nadia Vyacheslavna. So I have a question. Can such social media platform as YouTube or Instagram have an impact on shaping an athlete's identity? YouTube and Instagram have an impact on shaping, forming of personal identity, sport of an athlete or sportsman. Идентичности спортсмена.
Да. Yes.
Thank you.
Всегда приятно получить однозначный ответ. Надежда Вячеславовна, спасибо. Никакой двусмысленности. Светлана Андреевна, пожалуйста. И готовится у нас Гуркина Анна Павловна.
Good afternoon, dear ladies and gentlemen. My theme, history of sports movement development in Volgograd. The purpose of the current study is a theoretical substantiation of the model and the priorities of sports movement development in Volgograd. First and foremost, our report will consist of mainly two parts: the historical background and modern tendencies of sports movement development in our region. In general, physical education and sports are among the main social institutions of modern society. They are responsible for healthy lifestyle development for every person and the entire social system. We can be noted that an important part of the social policy of our state is the care of the development of physical education and sports. This is due to the fact that through the exercise movement, humanistic values and norms are formed. Thus, we can see that the modern society requires new forms in the development of mass physical education. Unfortunately, the archival data on the breakup of sports movement in Stalingrad until 1947 are almost non-existent. But it should be noted that in the pre-war period in Stalingrad actively formed sports infrastructure. It was established that in 1930 in Stalingrad active construction of sports facilities. Thus, the stadium which was opened on the basis of Stalingrad tractor plant begins to operate. We can note with confidence that the pre-war Stalingrad was a large sports city with its developed infrastructure. This has led to a significant increase in physical education in the region. Various sports events were held at various venues of professional organizations. A great contribution to the development of the sports sector in the work of Stalingrad Regional Committee for Physical Education and Sports. It is generally agreed today that the Second World War made its own adjustments. The sports movement was forced to recognize itself on a military basis. After the Battle of Stalingrad, there was almost nothing left of the sports infrastructure. Work began on the restoration of the Hero City. It is worth nothing that the state supported the sports movement during the Second World War. Thus, in 1943, the All Union Committee for Physical Education and Sports decided to provide assistance to physical education organizations. In 1943, the National Committee on Physical Education and Sports decided to establish a national sports organization. In the post-war period, funding for physical education and sports was low. No funds were allocated for sports events. As a result, it was only by 1948 that the first five-year plan for the production of sports equipment was proposed. As a part of the Stalingrad sports movement, voluntary sports societies were organized to provide assistance from industrial organizations in the field of physical education and sports. So, such sports communities as Traktor, Spartak, Builder were organized. As a result, by the end of 1945, some stadiums were restored. Of course, at the time, there were many problems in the field of physical training and sports. For example, lack of equipment, uniforms, gymnasiums were not equipped. Perhaps we should also point out the fact that the lack of the physical facilities has that contributed to the low number of people engaged in physical activity. But despite this, one of the main positive aspects was the restoration of the city physical education and sports committee. Gradually, the system of physical education and sports of this hero city began to consider it as a form of leisure of its citizens. With the end of the Great Patriotic War, the country's priorities were directed towards peacetime. Already by 1946, the sports community director restored the stadium, which has a large football field, treadmill, locker rooms, and gymnastic town. According to results of the first post-war five-year plan in the Hero City, there were about 220 equipment for sports grounds. In the following years, physical education and sports developed in the direction of mass participation. For the great majority of people at the time, the development of sports movement reached its apogee. There were about 246 sections in various sports. Thus, they view the sports movement as a subjective aspect of the life of citizens in the urban environment. Therefore, it is part of the development, a healthy way of life and the city as a whole. Nowadays, an important point is that the residents of the hero city of Volgograd support the policy of the president of the Russian Federation, Putin, who was created a nationwide patriotic movement for the improvement of Russian citizens by means of physical education and sports. In conclusion, it can be said that the regional level work is being done with the population and confidence are being created for the development of sports movement. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Светлана Андреевна, вопросы? Да, пожалуйста, Александр.
Светлана, thank you. Could you please name some athletes or researchers who have made a significant contribution into the sports development in Volgograd, or maybe some the names of some famous athletes who were born in Volgograd?
Thank you for your question. I say very popular athlete. This is Slesarenko Lebedeva. This is Olympic champion. In Volgograd, we can many Olympic people. For example, Sadovy, can be Olympic championship in swimming pool.
Thank you.
Спасибо. И у нас последняя выступающая Анна Павловна Гуркина. Наверное, тяжело выступать последнему, но зато пришла мощная группа поддержки. Я так и понял, судя по надписи. Пожалуйста.
Dear Chairman, Commission members, and everyone present. Smolensk region is and always has been among the first regions of Russia in terms of sports development. This is evidenced by the number and condition of sports infrastructure facilities, the number of tournaments of different levels held in the region, the number of people who regularly play sports and have passed the ready for work and defense tests. Sportsmen are not born with built-in social qualities. These qualities enhance social maturity of the person, form along with the process of active work under the influence of many factors. One of these factors is the formation of a highly moral educational environment. The priority in the university's educative work is in creating favorable conditions for it. Research object, purpose, tasks, and practical applications are presented on the slides. In the 30s, the emergence of Soviet sports contributed to massive development of physical culture and sports in the country. This created prerequisites for the creation of a College of Physical Culture in the Smolensk region. On the 1st of September 1930, the Smolensk College of Physical Culture opened its doors to its first students. From the first days of the Second World War, most students and teachers went to the battlefront and many heroically died for our motherland. On the 22nd of June 1941, at the stadium of the House of the Red Army, students and teachers of the Smolensk College of Physical Culture took part in a sports parade and track and field competitions. Ivan Ivanovich Shkodin, a teacher of the Smolensk College, set two world records in race walking that day. The college grew and developed, and in 1950, by the order of Council of Ministers of the USSR, it was reorganized into an institute. In 2005, taking into account the high educational and scientific potential of the teaching staff, the Ministry of Education and Science of the Russian Federation transformed the institute into the Academy of Physical Culture, Sports and Tourism. Very little time has passed, and in 2021, the Academy has acquired a new status. It became the Smolensk State University of Sports, which we are proud to present. Our university has made a great contribution to the development of physical culture and sports in our country. In Smolensk, the first bicycles appeared in late 1880s. In November 1890, a society of cyclists was established at the provincial center. The Smolensk Society of Cyclists soon began to popularize cycling among women. Since 1914, tourist cycling trips have been organized in Smolensk. The first one took place on the 1st of May on the route Smolensk-Gnezdovo-Smolensk. In 1926, it was decided to hold the first cyclocross competitions. In 1927, junior competitions were held for the first time in Smolensk. In 1928, 33 Smolensk athletes took part in the all-union Spartakiad. In the 1935, a bike ride along the route Smolensk-Leningrad-Moscow-Smolensk became a significant event in the sports life of the city as well as in the entire western part of the country. For the first time in the practice of cycling, women participated in the event. The Department of Cycling and Speed Skating was established in university in 1955. The staff of the department has achieved significant success in sports work. More than 200 and a half masters of sports and more than 60 masters of sport of international class studied at the department. More than 50 students took part in the Olympic Games, World and European Championships, including such outstanding athletes as Терещенко, Соломя, Куповец, Гусятников, Ковш, Гришина, Брежнева, Войнова, Шмелева, Хатинцева, and many others. The first records of the developments of track and field in Smolensk region date back to 1924. The pre-war press wrote about the competitions between the Smolensk clubs named after Tomsk and Smirnov. Very soon, at the end of the September 1924, Smolensk was represented at the Open Union Olympiad. In these competitions, three Smolensk athletes managed to win medals at once. In 1926, Smolensk athletes won awards at all Russian and regional competitions. The 40s of the 20th century were marked by a new stage in the development of track and field. In 1944, the local youth sports school resumed its work and accepted 60 students. It held classes in track and field, gymnastics, fencing, tumbling, boxing, football, and hockey. In 1945, a Komsomol trade union cross was held in the Smolensk region, in which 5,500 people took part. When the College of Physical Education appeared in Smolensk in 1930, Sergei Vinogradov and Vladlen Brushko became the first athletic coaches who worked there and raised the first champions of Russia in the USSR. An important role in the development of athletics played the athletics department of the Smolensk Institute. The Smolensk region is the birthplace of such famous athletes as Alexei Fyodorov, Sergei Enkofartyom, Ilya Ivanyuk, Svetlana Shkolina, and Olga Kuzenkova. And also many other honored coaches of the USSR and Russia. Саматиосов Вячеслав Дмитриевич, Михенко Федор Тимофеевич, Телегин Василий Иванович, Морозов Геннадий Георгиевич. The history of Smolensk football began in 1908. Students studying in Moscow and Petrograd came to Smolensk for the summer holidays. Some of them played in the teams of the capital cities. The first match was held between the teams of students from Moscow and Petrograd. Soon, in Smolensk Football League was organized. The strongest at the time was the team of the Society of Physical Development. After the revolution, the Smolensk Sport Club became the leader of local football. The university football team was established in 1967. For more than 50 years, the team has been successfully competing in city, regional, Russian, and all union competitions. For the last 10 years, the university team has annually become the winner of the regional championship, 4 times the winner of the regional cup. Since 2010, the team has been regularly competing in all competitions held under the auspices of the RFU and NSFL. It's a regular participant of the final tournaments of the Russian championship among universities. The city has developed a system of student football champions competitions. The university team is the winner of the National Student Football League 2017. In 2018, it became silver medalist of the football tournament of the European University Games. And in 2019, it took the 6th place at the first ever Students World Cup in China. Participation in the Olympic Games is every athlete's dream. The representatives of our region have also had bright moments when they won medals or fought for them. The LA dedicated to the sports glory of graduates will be built in 2023. It will be a complex of 23 stalls decorated with portraits of Olympic champions, graduates of our university, as well as information about their achievements and symbols of their sports. The main idea of this project, embodying the connection between past and present generations, is to perpetuate the memory of outstanding athletes who glorified our university, as well as the formation of a highly moral educational environment for the younger generation and teaching the values of physical culture and sports. Thank you.
Высокий темп речи мы прослушали. Да, грамотно, но очень быстро, на мой взгляд. Значит, вопросы?
You have conducted very interesting research, historical research, and I have a question. What experience of developing sports in your region is most successful and can be used in developing sports in other regions of our country, in your opinion?
Can you repeat the question, please?
What experience of developing sports in your region is most successful and this experience, what experience can be used in developing sports in other regions of our country?
Thank you.
In your opinion?
Of course. Our university trains teachers of physical culture and coaches in many different branches of sports, and it also maintains strong links with all the federations of the region, and our university holds competition on its grounds. And there's also a multi-sport junior school within the university, so I can say that our region is developing many kinds of sports successfully, I think.
Спасибо, Анна Павловна. Можете занять свое место, правда, ненадолго пока. Уважаемые дамы и господа, хочу вас поблагодарить за все выступления. Все выступления были содержательны, интересны. И, насколько я понял, согласно процедуре, вы должны сейчас покинуть аудиторию, чтобы не мешать подведению итогов. Прошу вас. Уважаемые коллеги, позвольте поздравить вас с окончанием, окончательным окончанием работы сессии конференции нашей секции. Значит, компьютер все тщательно посчитал, избавил меня от персональной необходимости высказывать свое мнение, то есть у нас не было по результатам подсчета компьютеров никаких совпадений, и мне не нужно было, что называется, разводить людей, кого-то ставить выше, кого-то ниже, основываясь на собственных предпочтениях. Все определил компьютер на основе подсчета баллов. И по результатам подсчета, мне начать с первого места или с третьего? С третьего подрастали ситуации. Третье место у нас занял Барабанов Никита Алексеевич. Барабанов Никита Алексеевич, поздравления. Второе место. Гудковская Антонина Тимофеевна. И первое место. Федоренко Юлия Валерьевна. Общее количество набранных, уже представлено. Общее количество набранных баллов вы можете посмотреть. Угу. И позвольте еще раз выразить вам благодарность за участие в секционной работе и пожелать всего самого наилучшего в вашей научной работе, учебной работе и вообще в жизни. Всего самого-самого хорошего.